Hi and welcome to my free Java video course. My name is Markus Biel. In this episode, I will talk about the Java interface comparable. Okay, let's jump in. Before getting technical, let me clarify the most important question. What is the comparable interface actually used for? Look at these five apples. If we want to sort them, we must put them in a certain order. To establish this order, we have to compare them with each other. To do this, we continuously ask the question, does this apple come before that apple? Until the list is sorted. Answering that question is what the comparable interface does. In a nutshell, while comparable is used in the sorting process, it cannot sort the objects on its own. The comparable interface defines just one method, int_compareTo. T is a generic type. In our case, it will be the type apple. As a concrete example, you call the compareTo method on one apple, and you give it another apple to compare itself to. So in our example, the result of the comparison could be less than, equal to, or greater than the other apple. But how do we know if one apple is actually less than, equal to, or greater than the other apple? If this apple is considered less than the other apple, we have to return an arbitrary negative number. Minus 454, for example. If both apples are considered equal, we have to return 0. Finally, if this apple is considered greater than the other apple, we have to return an arbitrary positive number, 42, for example. Until now, we have used apples of various sizes to emphasize how one apple might differ from another. However, that's not the whole story. There are many other characteristics that could be used to sort apples. I just use the size for illustrative purposes. First, our client must precisely define how he wants the apples to be sorted. Does he want the apple sorted by variety? And what does sorted by variety actually mean? For example, we could sort the apples alphabetically by variety name or by the variety unit price. Second, our client must clarify what less than, equal to, and greater than mean to him. As an example, our client might decide to sort by the apple's color. In this case, which color will be first, second, and third? It's even possible to sort by multiple characteristics, which we'll see in an example later. Okay, let's put all this into practice. May I introduce you to Fatty Farmer, our client. As you might have guessed, he wants us to write a program that will sort his apples. In the first version, he wants the apples sorted by weight. Implementing the sorting logic is quite simple. We can do it with just one line of code. Collection sort will do it all for us. If we defined how to compare apples beforehand. But one step at a time. Based on the farmer's requirements, we first have to design an apple class. In our example, every apple has a variety, a color, and a weight. For illustrative purposes, keeping things simple, the variety will be represented as a string, the color as an enum, and the weight as a primitive int. So here's our first version of class apple. Because our program will sort apples, the apple class needs to implement the comparable interface, so let's quickly add that. Comparable is a generic interface. With apple in angle brackets, we define that an object of type apple can be compared to other apple objects. Okay, now it starts to get exciting. We're now ready to implement our first compareTo method. As I said before, in this first version, we will compare apples by weight. So we add a first if condition for the case that this weight is less than the other apple's weight. Do you remember what we have to return in this case? Pause the video and think about it. Exactly, a negative number. To keep it simple, let's return minus 1. What do we have to return if both weights are equal? Pause the video and think about it. 0, exactly. Now if this weight is not less than or equal to the other weight, then it must be more than the other weight. Therefore, we don't need a third if statement and can directly return the value that represents greater than. Do you still remember what we have to return in this case? Pause the video and think about it. Exactly, a positive number. Let's return 1 to counter the minus 1 from the first condition. Okay, we have successfully implemented our first compare to method. Hooray! Fireworks! Party time! Now let's take a closer look at our compare to implementation. Can you think of an easier way to do this? Pause the video and think about it for a moment. Well, do you think we're the first developers comparing to int values with each other? Probably not. It's generally better to reuse existing code than to reinvent the wheel. The best code is the code that was never written. So now the idea is to replace this code block by calling an existing method to do the heavy work for us. Something like this, for example. However, this is not quite the whole story, because weight is not an object, but a primitive int value, which does not provide a compare to method. The primitive int has a corresponding integer wrapper type. It provides the static method compare that we can use to compare to primitive int values. So this single line of code is equivalent to our previous version. There are many classes in the JDK that implement the comparable interface. For example, all primitive wrapper classes, as well as string and enum. Okay. So Fatty Farmer was very happy with our program. Now that he sees what is generally possible, of course he wants just another little feature. For version 2, Fatty Farmer wants us to sort by multiple characteristics. First, he wants us to sort the apples by variety. However, when two apples have the same variety, he wants us to sort them by color. Finally, if both variety and color are the same, he wants us to sort the apples by weight. But this time, we will make use of the compare to methods provided by string, enum, and integer. So as requested by Fatty Farmer, we start by comparing the variety. If the result is not zero, it means our apples are not of the same variety and we can leave the method. However, if the two apples are of the same variety, we have to compare the apples' color. Now the same condition applies. If they have different colors, we can leave the method. However, if both apples have the same variety and color, we do need to compare their weights. Finally, we return the result. Now look at the code we implemented. Are you happy with it? Is there something you would like to improve? Pause the video and think about it. Exactly, it contains duplicate code. And duplicate code is evil, so let's clean that up. As you can see, these two code blocks are executed only if the result is zero. That means if the result is not zero, both blocks will be skipped. Therefore, we can simply remove the two other code blocks. This, by the way, is a good example of what you do as a clean coder too. Usually, you don't instantly write clean code. You start with a rough idea, make it work, and then continuously improve it until you can feel that it's clean. Okay, let's get back to the comparable interface. There are a few more things I would like to tell you. You may have noticed that the compare to method resembles the hashCode and equals methods to some extent. However, there is an important difference. For hashCode and equals, the order in which you compare individual attributes has a big impact on the performance, but it does not influence the value returned. However, the order in which you compare attributes in the compareTo method defines the way in which the objects will be sorted. For example, it is used by the two utility classes javautilArrays and javautilCollections to sort elements and to search for elements in sorted collections. With collections like treeSet or treeMap, it's even easier, they automatically sort the elements which have to implement the comparable interface. To be honest, there is more you need to know to completely fulfill the contract of the comparable interface. To learn about this, I highly recommend that you read item 12 from the second edition of Effective Java by Josh Block, which also happens to be one of my favorite Java books. And that's it for this episode. If you have any questions, leave a comment below this video, and please remember to give me a thumbs up before you go. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.